Now, please, let's extend a very warm welcome to our distinguished guests, Lisa LaFlamme and Elizabeth Dubois.
And I say right off the bat, it's really, I feel like Alex is right watching over my shoulder, and he's saying, don't screw this up, LaFlamme. I could just tell Alex stories all night. It's great to meet you, Jean, tonight. See you again, Matthew. Amazing to be here. Great to be with you, Elizabeth.
It's so great to be here. Thank you so much for taking the time. This, as we've had from the intro, is going to be a big conversation. We have a lot to get through.
A lot to cover. 40 years is a long time.
I want to start with an easy one, though. Just reflecting on what UOttawa means. We heard what UOttawa meant to Alex, and I wonder if you could speak a little bit about some of your memories of being on campus. What's it like to be back?
It's amazing to be back, always, but you just said something that reminds me. I have to tell this story, especially because you're here. Years and years and years ago, University of Ottawa had an event in Toronto to raise money from some of the alumni in Toronto. So Alex was there, and I think it was the first time I met him. This was many years ago, and I was expected to introduce Alex Trebek. Oh my God, stress. So I say, not knowing the sense of humor that he had at that time, yes, I mean, it's an honor to be introducing the great Alex Trebek, who graduated from University of Ottawa before I was born. And from the wings, just loud enough, I heard, bitch. And that really cemented our relationship for years, because he is always so honest. He's taught me so much about, actually about broadcasting, being in the public eye. So many of the things I learned, I got from him. But your question is about University of Ottawa and my memories, and I have so many, not the least of which is my very best friend to this day. I met her on her very first day of school, 1984, in the same dumpy boarding house that should have been condemned and eventually was, 246 Laurier Avenue. funny what you remember. Anyway, but I didn't live on campus, but I worked on campus. I was the overnight switchboard operator at Thompson Residence from midnight till 8 a.m. in my first year. Good evening, bonsoir, Thompson. Comment je vous aider? How can I help you? And I'm telling you, that was an education, watching students stumble in at all hours of the night. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to communication, the communications department, of which you are a fabulous prof, and I had so many great profs at the time, it was also the very first time I ever sat at a computer, because it was 1984, so it was, of course, the size of a refrigerator, but it was still a computer, and it was a course. It might be hard for the students to believe this, but one of the course requirements was learn how to use a computer. And we used to sit there with the DOS flashing green light. Anybody of a certain age may remember that. And you could sign up to sit at a computer in the basement of the communications department. I don't know what's in that basement now, but that was there then. And who knew 40 years later, more than 40 years later, it would be, you know, in the palm of our hand. Yeah. And really control us on so many levels. I suppose we delivered our essays during my time here, handwritten or typed. It's hard to even believe that, but it's true. Now, of course, I'm sure it's all AI putting them out, right, students?
Well,
kidding.
That's a conversation for another time. Was it before or after sitting next to a computer that was probably four times your size that you decided to be a journalist?
Oh, my goodness. Long before that, I knew I didn't know it was called journalism. But I knew as a little kid, I was always writing. I was always, I suppose, in a family full of girls. I have four sisters. I was the mouthiest. So it may have seemed like storytelling was my goal or in my future. But in grade 9, I went to the guidance counselor and said, I want to be a reporter. And she said, okay, you need physics.
Now, of course.
I got to be honest, in 35 sense. Years as a journalist, I never used physics. But I managed to scrape through at like 70% thanks to Sister Mary Vivian, wherever she is now, but St. Mary's High School. Anyway, I always knew, and I'm grateful for having known that, because I know so many students and graduates who struggle with what to do, what is their passion. And I will always argue it's about finding that passion, because it makes your life a lot more interesting and satisfying. It also is a midlife crisis if you don't find it, because eventually it'll haunt you. But so I accept that I was lucky that I knew this is what I wanted. And I wanted to be a foreign correspondent my whole life. It's so strange. In fact, when I first started in local news, my very first television job in my hometown was, I'd worked radio that morning, and the assignment editor said, so-and-so, Ingrid Clark, has called in sick. I still remember her name. She called in sick. Can you pull a television shift? And I said, okay, and immediately phoned my mother and said, what am I going to wear? You know, had no idea. Anyway, they sent me to the bar that I'd gone to my entire high school years. You could drink underage in Kitchener, obviously. But and it was a psychic fair. That is what I covered.
It was a psychic fair.
A psychic fair.
What was your angle on the story?
Well, I was participatory journalism, because I had them read my cards. I made my sisters and my friends come. And amazingly, they saw this psychic, who's clearly a genius, saw Flags of the World. And at that moment, as a 24-year-old local reporter, I could never have dreamed that what would unfold. It makes me a bit emotional, because it's been a privilege to cover the world. And I'm never supposed to get emotional here.
All right, well, then you're not going to like the next question.
Boy.
You've had such an incredible career, and as you reflect on it, I'm wondering if you can share with us some of the stories that have been most important to you personally that you've covered.
Oh, wow. It's really a long list, but I think the most pivotal that ended up becoming the foundation of my career, really, was the morning, and I'm going to give you a bit of backstory. I was working here in Ottawa. I was a parliamentary correspondent for CTV. It was my dream job. All I ever wanted to do was, I loved politics, covering politics. So I was doing the job, and then I get the phone call offering me the co-host of Canada AM, which was a huge job. I was so honored, but also conflicted, because I don't cook in my real life, and I was all of a sudden going to have to cook on national television, because that's the beauty of a morning show. You have to do the balance. Anyway, I said yes. I moved back to Toronto from Ottawa, and I started on September 10th, 2001. And at that, after the show that morning, I walked in the dog park. I was so crying my eyes out. What have I done? I can't believe I'm doing fashion tips on TV, and I've just left. It was just felt so strange to me, and I was nervous that I'd made the wrong decision. The next morning at 8:45 in the morning, a producer got in my ear and said, "A plane has just hit, one of the trade towers. We don't know what it is, but just tell the viewers, we'll come to live coverage after a commercial break." So, okay. And I, like so many, thought it was a small plane crash. And we begin live coverage at 8:45 that morning. When the second plane hit the second tower, I remember saying live on air, okay, I think we might be seeing a replay here. Because how could this possibly be? A second plane, and then the Pentagon, and then the farm field in Pennsylvania, and the world changed. That day, that moment, And we had a marathon broadcast that morning. Then Lloyd Robertson came in at 1 o'clock, and I got in a van to New York City and got to New York at about 1 o'clock in the morning. We got right down to Wall Street. We weren't supposed to, but we were just two women with no camera equipment. And we just got there covering our faces. The air was still acrid, as you can imagine, and shoes everywhere. And I remember we started at 6 o'clock in the morning or 5 o'clock in the morning. Just we did live round the clock coverage for 12 days. And it became the first time I left a story where I could still see the smoldering from the World Trade Center and feeling that sense of you're abandoning a story, because it clearly wasn't over for Americans, it wasn't over for the world, and it led me to realizing I really do need to get back in the field. So I did my commitment to Canada AM, but then I had to go to Iraq, and where I spent 3 years, and then Afghanistan for the next 10 years, back and forth. Because it was that important to really get to the bottom of what is happening in this world. And we're still, look at today, we're in yet another conflict, war, tragedy, civilians losing their lives this way. And it really changed my life, and it's still a key part of my life. So I guess my answer is 9/11 changed everything.
Yeah, it's incredible to be able to reflect on that and see how that's changed your career, has changed, I mean, so many people's lives. Can you speak a little more about how being not only there, but in these other places that you've reported from, Iraq, Afghanistan, Ukraine, you've been to as well, how does that change your worldview? How does that change your approach?
Well, I think my worldview is formed by it. Mm-hmm. Through the experiences, what I would say, including right now, again, what we're seeing in the Middle East, I do always, and I have always tried as a reporter, to find the humanitarian side, because the political side, even the military side, that's sort of sharp corners. And I always have felt this is about people. Their lives are just being thrown up. And when you arrive somewhere, it is the worst moment in their lives, and you're saying to them, okay, tell me. I mean, it's so trite almost, but I've always wanted to sort of show Canadians, this is what's happening, this is the reality on the ground. And what I've always learned in the worst, darkest moments is just the power of human spirit, actually. I've always been overwhelmed at the worst possible moments. People have this instinct for survival and instinct for their children and to have a better life and to keep fighting for it. And I have to tell one story that is so strong for me, that's just come to my head, but it was Women's Day around 2006, International Women's Day. And I, and in the days leading up to it, five beautiful young Afghan girls were going to school and had acid thrown in their faces. And I remember thinking, okay, this was the first time we'd heard of that tactic by the Taliban. I needed to get into a school and talk to some of these girls. And I thought, there's none of them are going to be at school. I mean, it's terrifying to go back to school knowing the risk. These five girls, three of whom died, by the way, two survived. Anyway, I get access to a school. They give me permission to go in. My cameraman is not allowed in, so he quickly teaches me how to turn this thing on, and I set the camera up. I go in. The girls take their burqas off. They're just so fascinated. A woman traveling without her brother, without her father. You have your own passport. does your father know you're here? By the way, he was not happy I was there. He would much rather I'd been home in Kitchener-Waterloo. But anyway, I learned so much from those girls who wanted to be doctors and lawyers and journalists. And I think today, when you see through the prism of what's happening now in Afghanistan, those girls were probably 10, 12 then. They had 20 years of progress. You know, they learned things about what's possible. And while it looks extremely dark right now, I just believe, like the chancellor said, it's going to be somehow the power of women in that country, who I've seen the strongest people in the world from Afghanistan. Some are dear and close to my heart are here tonight.
I was going to say.
But I know this isn't the end. It's just a massive roadblock in the journey for women in that country.
Absolutely.
We can't turn our back on them is really what I want to say.
Yeah. In Afghanistan and in so many places, women and girls are at most risk during humanitarian crises, and the toll is taken very strongly by women. And I know that women's education is a particularly important issue for you. You've already talked a little bit about Afghanistan and the very special guests we have here today. I wondered if you might share a little bit about Roya Shams and your family's experience.
Roya, would you like to stand up, my dear? This is my surrogate daughter, Roya Shams. And Roya came into my life, what were you, 14, 15? Showed up, did not speak a word of English, and through the good, really the generosity of Canadians who brought her here through the Toronto Star. My partner was the editor-in-chief of the Star, Michael Cook, and it was a really concerted effort to try to save one girl. And we got, Roya came to Canada, Ashbury College gave her an education, an amazing high school education. And I remember the day when Roya was about to graduate and I phoned up Alan Rock, who was the president of Ottawa U at the time, and I said, Alan, does the university have any kind of scholarship for students who've overcome extreme obstacles? I mean, we're talking a war zone. And he said, I don't know, we're gonna do a task force. So they did a task force, and I'm so proud to say that now, inspired by Roya, there is an amazing scholarship here at University of Ottawa for not just war survivors, but also indigenous communities where, you know, they do not have the same kind of quality of education, sadly, or the ability to get and afford a university. So that's something this university has done. But then we fast forward to the fall of Kabul in August 2021, and Roya calling me and saying, I mean, we both immediately were thinking of her family who were still in Kandahar. She said, what are we going to do? We have to do something. And we started right then. And I said, well, give me a list, thinking it would be like five names. And she gave me a list of 37 names. I thought, OK, I don't know what we're going to do. But I am so proud to say every one of them are here in Ottawa. Many of them are here tonight. And our country is much the better for having you. And this is a fight we that is not over. The work is not over yet.
No, absolutely it isn't. And I know that some of the work that you've been doing in the last year or two has involved continued humanitarian work. But before we get to what you're up to right now, I want to go back to journalism and what it looks like and what it's meant for you. I wonder if you can share maybe the funnest story that you ever got to cover.
Okay, I've had a lot of fun. I mean, even though it sounds pretty grim, covering war is not fun, but I guess I'm also a huge music fan. Anybody who knows me well knows I can't stop singing, it's my stress reliever, and I'm a huge Beatles fan. And so one day, again, this was a Canada AM day, I get the call, we would like you to go to London to interview Paul McCartney.
Oh,
I didn't have
that
to
seems
think
like
of,
a pretty great
I didn't have to think about that one long. I mean, I knew everything about the Beatles, everything about Paul. I loved him, although I was really a Beatle John fan. But anyway, I get to London, Abbey Road, which, of course, I had walked across the zebra crossing as a teenager. And there I am in Abbey Road Studios. And I'm writing down some notes, last-minute notes, and I hear this voice from behind in a full Liverpudlian accent, "LaFlamme, I don't want any trouble from you." I look up, and there's Paul McCartney, and it was just an amazing moment. And we had this fun, great interview, and I was trying to work up the guts to ask him. I'd heard this rumor somewhere that the original lyrics to Yesterday were quite funny. And I say to him something like, you know, I've heard this rumor, original lyrics of Yesterday, and he says, "Come here, lass." So I go over to the piano, I'm sitting on the beautiful piano bench beside Sir Paul, and he starts playing "Scrambled Eggs, Ooh Baby, How I Love Your Legs." And those are the original words of Yesterday, because he wrote the music first. And so the lyrics were just placeholders. Anyway, it was a great moment, and I had a lot of fun over the years, but most memorable, I gotta hand it to
You really Paul. Couldn't get away from cooking on that Canada Day.
You're right. Scrambled eggs. That's right. I still don't make them, but
that's an incredible
I ate
story.
Them for breakfast today, though. They were pretty good.
Nice, nice. So journalism over the course of your career has shifted and changed a lot. The news cycle is very different from when you began. The technologies that are used are different. The way journalists are expected to interact with the public is drastically different. Can you speak about what you see as the biggest or most impactful changes?
Wow, that's a big question, because it's a different world, actually. And I would say the biggest impact is social media, without a doubt, and the rise of misinformation and disinformation. And I think that it's behind the erosion of public trust in our public institutions. It's behind the polarization of societies around the world and in Canada, sadly. The level for female journalists, it's the level of misogyny and hate, toxicity on social media is so next level, especially for my racialized friends and colleagues, that it breaks my heart, actually, because I know women, and not just in this country, in many countries, who said, you know what, it's not worth it. The hate that they receive. And again, I think to myself, we all somehow have allowed this or let this grow, and we haven't wrangled it yet. We still haven't wrangled it. And some countries are imposing regulations, legislation, but it's changed journalism so much that actual traditional journalism, we're seeing massive shrinking of traditional media outlets and a rise in outlets that really we can't even define sometimes. Is this real news, or what is the motivation behind this site? It's particularly damning right now. I would say democracy is a cliffhanger right now, so much so that even Gen Z is paying attention. Mm-hmm. And you gotta know we're in rough shape, really, when that happens. It's a sad but true statement, but
yeah.
the thing we need to recognize is this is all a plan by authoritative governments, you know, to sort of overload a system with so many lies that you short-circuit it. Yeah. And then people don't know what to believe. So the first thing they seem to do is offload, because they would believe, if you look at, you know, I just returned, I should say, from the Philippines on Sunday. And under the influence of, we have some Filipinos here. Salamat po! But, I mean, then you can relate to the fact that, you know, in 2016, we may think about it was the year Donald Trump was elected in the United States of America and called the media enemies of the people. But at the same time, Rodrigo Duterte was elected in Philippines and called us prostitutes. So there was an overall influence of very influential people who decided that the messengers were the ones who needed to be dismissed.
And it's a narrative that we see continue, and it's embedded in a lot of online chatter, in a lot of different groups and communities across the internet and offline. It's not all the internet's fault. And
it's true.
And
I'll
we
give you that.
See, you know, it's not just one-off leaders in other places that are saying these kinds of things.
Right,
it's embedded now.
And I always think to myself, so if you had a lump in your breast, would you go to Instagram for advice? Or if you needed a divorce lawyer, would you go to Twitter? Why then, when a major news story breaks, would you just believe the echo chamber of name it? I mean, there's just so many. And that is what deeply concerns me about, really, as I say, it's the state of democracy. I mean, journalism is the elbow grease of democracy, the practitioner who, it's a profession. We learn how to differentiate fact from fiction, gather it, put it in context, disseminate it. It is not, it's not just something you just spout off, you know. If you're any good, you've done your homework and your research. And I think it's really disturbing to see that the craft and the profession of journalism has taken such a hit because of some of that oxygen coming at us from people who may not have our best interest at heart, let me put it that way.
Yeah, yeah. I wonder if you can talk a little bit about the locality of journalism, I guess, the role of reporters on the ground. We think about foreign correspondents getting cut from newsrooms. We think about local journalistic organizations shrinking, dying off. Small town reporters don't have ways to get funded anymore. And I wonder if that creates a gap that people need to fill who don't have journalistic background.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, it does a lot of things. First of all, on your point, shrinking newsrooms, you close all of your foreign bureaus, and then a massive war breaks out, and there's nobody there to cover it.
Yeah.
So I would say no Canadian outlet, and a lot of American outlets and British outlets closed their Middle East bureaus. So when that war broke out, it was about parachuting on October 7th, the terror attack in Israel. They parachuted reporters in. Now, that it's not possible to always be everywhere, but particularly this crisis requires experience and context, because it is a very complicated and ultimately one of the most tragic things any of us has probably seen in a long time.
And it wasn't a one-day event. It wasn't parachute somebody in who's normally posted somewhere else for a day or two.
Mm-hmm.
This is ongoing.
That's exactly right. And I would say in local newsrooms, we were just mentioning the erosion of trust, and I actually think it kind of can go back to shrinking local newsrooms, because, you know, you used to know your Ron Burgundy action news team, who your weatherman was and who your sports guy was and the news people, but that was relationship building.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I actually can speak from experience. One time I thought, you know, I just graduated from here and I was in my first newsroom, I've got my degree, I'm ready to take on the world. And the assignment editor instead sends me, and I am not kidding, to cover a three-legged cat up a tree. Nope, not a word of a lie. The cat's name is Tripod. So I, of course, am like watching the Pulitzer Prize slip through my fingers. And I get there, and the entire neighborhood is surrounding this tree, looking up at Tripod, who's not budging. The fire trucks, I'm not kidding, the fire trucks have raised their ladders and the whole bit. But in the time I was there, the moms of that Cameron Street is where it was, I still remember where, said to me, oh, you work for CKCO, okay. The real story is there's no crosswalk here, and we've had like 11 kids injured on trying to get, it was never as busy, it's getting busier, this street, as the kids are trying to get to school, to cross the street. So I thought, okay, this is interesting. So the next day, again, it was the 80s, we bring a surveillance camera, which was also the size of a fridge, and we set it up at the corner, and we get enough evidence to prove this is these kids are taking their life in their hand trying to cross the street to go to school. We did a series of stories on that street in that city, and the city was shamed into not just putting up a crosswalk, but a street light, an actual street light, and they have tripod to thank. but mostly they have the relationship building. That was trust. They trusted me.
Yeah.
Oh, this girl works for the local news. It's diminishing, and we don't realize what we're letting go because nobody's talking about the relationship building that occurs between your local team, your local community, those boring Wednesday City Hall meetings. That's where the stories are. That's where we hold feet to the fire, and you learn it as a young reporter, making sure they're not, you know, using city funds in the wrong way. And then that translates right up here to Parliament Hill years later and global leaders. So it's not by accident that we are seeing an erosion of trust. Obviously, I'm very biased. I feel that it's connected to the shrinking of news and the priority of news for consumers, not just for us. It's all of us who have to care.
Absolutely, and it makes me think of some of the research that I'm doing right now, looking at social media influencers and their role in delivering political information and news content. In the context, in the Canadian context, there's Bill C-18, for anyone who likes to follow parliamentary stuff. There's a new legislation that Meta, the owner of Facebook and Instagram and Threads, responded to by saying, okay, no more news links on our platforms. We're just not going to share news links. And so people who are popular on social media, these influencers, started saying, all right, well, I can screenshot an image and then talk over it. And sometimes they're just giving the facts of the story that's behind them. But other times it's their opinion and they're adding this context, which sounds a little bit like the local context you were talking about, but isn't quite the same because it's still not people you necessarily know. Sometimes they're hired by people and you don't realize that. What do you think about this kind of meshing between influencer culture and journalistic training?
Well, if it's their opinion, I'm sorry, I don't care. I don't mean to be mean, but I don't want somebody's opinion. I mean, that's what the New York Times columnists are for, or the Globe and Mail, if I want opinion pieces. I feel that it's dangerous if you don't have the tools. Like I said, you're a practitioner, and there's a set of tools, just like if you're, okay, I am not comparing journalism to medicine, but there are tools for every trade, let's put it that way. I'll go back to the elbow grease concept. That is what we have learned, and it makes me nervous that people can take whatever their influences are and put it out there. And if they have a huge following, everyone's on side with that. But where in there are the facts? So this gives me pause.
Yeah.
And I will say, just today, the government did make an agreement with Google. $100 million Google will now pay to Canadian news organizations to maintain that Canadian news will be on Google when you search it. And to that I say, we don't know the details yet. Listen, folks, it's always been there. It's always been there. It's called subscribe to a newspaper or a great website or anything. There's such great journalism out there, and it might cost you a few bucks a month. But we need to, we as consumers also have some responsibility here. I hate to put the pressure back on you, everyone, but you have a choice. If you want good journalism, support good journalism, or else these influencers who don't have a journalism background are going to take up all of the room in the space, and there'll be nobody telling the facts.
Yeah, finding funding models that work and recognizing that sometimes for high quality information, somebody has to pay for it to be high quality.
Mm. But you're the prof. You've got to figure this out, you see.
I'm working on it.
Someone in the communications department at University of Ottawa is going to figure this out.
Yeah, what I'm seeing a lot of is this kind of meshing between journalism and other kinds of activities. And one of them that comes to mind, going back to the context of war zones, thinking about the lack of information coming out of Gaza, for example, right now, is a meshing between, you know, journalist and activist, or journalist and doctor, or journalist and whoever can actually be there, because when there's no journalists allowed in, the only voices are the people who are willing to kind of put themselves out there. How does that fit in from like a media and digital literacy perspective? You've talked a lot about journalists provide facts and information that needs to be trustworthy, and we have to look for that. What do we do when we don't have that?
Well, the limited access, you're absolutely right, is critically important and makes this a lot more of a challenge. But I can't help but think about the 57 journalists who have now been killed in this conflict, 57 in one month. And I think about these journalists do not have the big backing, certainly several from Al Jazeera who do have the financial backing. Friends of mine have lost very close friends who are in the journalistic community. Most of them, though, because of what you've just described, they don't have actually even flak jackets, helmets. They certainly do not have insurance. When they are killed while doing their job, their wives or husbands and children have nothing. They have nothing because they're small outlets, or they are the doctor at Al-Shifa Hospital or wherever who are giving you context of what their reality is at that moment. And I would say covering any war, the toughest part is when you're on the ground, is you are reporting on what you are seeing right there. That is your role, to give the picture from your zone. And it's exactly why I have to repeat what I said before. Context is so incredibly important. And you know what? There are 32 wars going on right now, right at this moment. And I spend so much time traveling from different trouble spot to another, and I realize so much of what I've done this year is the stuff that would never end up in a newscast. There are conflicts happening, people's lives, again, mothers and their children, and nobody's talking about them because there are other bigger stories, or the news cycle's too quick.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things going on right now that we need to focus on.
Yeah, absolutely. Can you tell us a little more about what you've been working on in the last year or so?
Yeah. So I've been doing a lot of work for Journalists for Human Rights, and I've traveled through many countries in Africa, focusing really on women's issues, to be honest, because they need a voice in some of these countries where they're fighting things we fought 40 years ago, even though the fight is still very much alive for women in here. And I was really overwhelmed, to be honest. I can think of a story in Kenya where during the pandemic there was an epidemic of rape for girls who were literally in lockdown with their abusers. So it was an epidemic, girls as young as 10 years old. And so this one woman, an incredible woman, and just my point in telling you this is that one person can make a difference. She saw this happening in her community, and she's like, these little girls were top of their class, and now they're cast to the curb because they were raped, they've become pregnant. She started a school in rural Kenya, about an hour and a half from Nairobi. It's called the Greenland School for Teenage Moms. And it was, I've never seen anything like it. There are 90 girls and their babies. The babies are in one room. The girls are studying in their perfect uniforms. When school is out for lunch break, they go back to their babies, then back to class. And this is an example of how journalism, and I unapologetically can tell this story, made a difference. Because one, it was an online outlet, saw this happening in this little tiny rural area, this school, which was really a decrepit building it is. It has almost no electricity. But what has it given them? A second chance. They put that on Facebook, and then a conventional media, the largest newspaper in Nairobi, saw it, and the story grew and grew because of one journalist saying, this is important. Now, I'm sad to say, but it's also amazing, there's 600 girls on a waiting list to go to that Greenland school, and they want to come from Rwanda and various countries, and it's only $400, $400 Canadian to put one of these girls through 1 year and feed her baby. It's just an incredible thing, and that was one woman, Purity Gikunda, who made that happen and is changing lives. She's literally changing lives and doing it with almost no money. So it's been an overwhelming year of seeing little pockets of things like that, that again, never crack. They don't crack newscasts or newspapers outside of the little tiny zone where they happen. But it's been a really eye-opening experience, especially in Philippines just now, where the level of intimidation against journalists is second to none. I mean, now it's university journalism students. A week ago, the military banged on the parents' door of a journalism student to intimidate the parents to convince the child, 18-year-old, not to continue in journalism, because journalism is such a threat to authoritarian governments, you know, because the democracy is the devil. But guess what? Democracy dies in darkness, so we need more journalism, not less.
Yeah.
And it's through this organization that I've had this chance to kind of just talk about it. I never did while I was working it. It's weird. I never bragged about how great journalism was, because it was your job.
You're in it. It feels a little too in the moment, maybe, to be able to comment on it. But now that you've had a bit of a step out, you can kind of reflect and see. It sounds like you're seeing on this much broader scale. All of the little ways it starts to filter through.
Right. I mean, I obviously always knew it was critically important and believed in journalism, but now I see it in a way I never did before, because I'm not there to cover it, which is to say, you land, you work 20 hours a day, you file your story, you get 2 hours of sleep, you do it again the next day, you just keep going. Now I can go and reflect a little more. So it's really been one of the silver linings of the last year for me, is to have more time to give to the things that I'm passionate about.
Incredible. I'm really glad that you're able to do that, and it sounds like the kind of work that you're doing is really connecting with a lot of people abroad, but also here, bringing these stories back and giving them a space, even though they're not going to be the top news headline tomorrow. I think it's really helpful. So thank you.
The problem is, it's only my tiny, crappy little Instagram that I'm learning to use. I have to say, you know, camera work is a skill, editing is a skill, audio is a skill, writing is a skill, and I really feel for young journalists who have to figure out how to do it all, because now even a little Instagram video seems to take me a ridiculously long amount of time to knock it out there, so
and
you better like it if you see it, because it took time.
And there's so many different platforms, and they're always changing.
Oh, man.
It's a lot of work. It's also, as you mentioned, a space where there can be a lot of hate, a lot of negativity. One of the research projects I've been doing is looking at online harassment of political journalists and other public figures. No surprise, people who aren't white men get a lot more of it. And it's a lot harder for them to manage, right? So people who are racialized, people who are women, they tend to get the kind of negativity that is very personal. It's often sexist, it's often racist. I know that you're unfortunately no stranger to getting hate. And I wanted to ask if you have thoughts on the best ways to deal with it. What's worked? What kind of support structures are helpful? How do journalists who are up and coming equip themselves to be best placed to deal with what is truly a horrible mm-hmm. reality of the job?
Well, I mean, you should know I've literally been in this business since harass was two words. So, but in those days, you know, someone had to be so mad, they had to get a piece of paper and get a pen and write a hate letter and put it in an envelope and a stamp. And that was a lot of hate and a lot of effort. Now it's just a keystroke and you are called just the most disgusting things. It's just off the charts disgusting. And I always think, do you have a mother? Do you have a sister? Do you have a wife? Do they know you're putting this out there? It shocks me to still. And I want to be shocked. And I would say I take these criticisms, I take them seriously, but I don't take them personally. And that is what I say to young women and young men who are, and anybody, old women, old men, whoever's got to wear this stuff. It's really hard. I've grappled with how to deal with it. Do you respond and give them oxygen? Do you ignore it because the idiot's got 20 followers? I don't know if there's a right or a wrong answer, but I would say the most important thing is you got to tell somebody. You've got to share this. If you are wearing this hate and vitriol, and you may not have a strong self-esteem or self-confidence, we are seeing what the impact of this can have. And so, I mean, it might sound too simplistic, but it's about a support system where I can say to my friends or my sisters, oh my God, you are not gonna believe what I've been called this time. And then we kind of try to laugh about it or something. Yeah. To diffuse how it actually does hurt. And I think we have to acknowledge that it does. But I would also say we as a society need to call it out more. And I think we need the government's help on this. Mm-hmm. We do need legislation as exists in other countries to cut down on harmful abuse online.
Yeah.
And that hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, particularly when it's targeted at journalists and other public figures specifically. I think about the way that a lot of the major platforms deal with harassment and hate on their platforms. It's first of all, they don't deal with it much. They just kind of leave it. But particularly when it's a public figure, they're kind of like, we're just not going to touch that because that's newsworthy. Yeah. And once it's newsworthy, then it can stay up.
Right now, and this has been going on for a few years, and I'm not the only one, obviously, I know that, it will just explode that Lisa LaFlamme is selling CBD oil or selling special face creams, and they've got your image or they fake headlines, the whole bit. I have tried through legal channels to pull this down. It's so insidious mm-hmm. that it is impossible to actually find the root of it.
Yeah.
And, you know, now I don't know. I am not selling CBD oil. I am not selling. But one woman said to me, I've just spent $350 on a face cream because it said you were endorsing it. And I wanted to give her $350. I felt so bad for that she got taken in by these scammers and fraudsters. And it's just, you know, it's very, very insidious, as I say.
Yeah. And it fits in with some of these larger conversations we've been having about how disinformation and misinformation starts to erode trust and what that means for our democratic systems. And we could go on for much longer, but I want to actually pause for a minute and bring some students up on stage to join us.
Hello.
So I'd like to welcome two students who are going to join us to give some questions from the audience. We've got Yulia Milalescu, who's a graduate of the University of Ottawa with a BA in psychology, Michelle Hennessy, who holds a Bachelor of and Master's of Communication from UOttawa, both of whom are current Faculty of Law Common Law Section students, and both of whom have been working in my PolCom Tech Lab for the past few years. Thank you both so much for agreeing to take part, and come on up.
Awesome. Two future lawyers, then? Is that
two one? Future lawyers.
Lawyers. I'm going to need a lawyer one of these days.
All right, who has the first question?
I do. Okay, mic is working. Thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure to be here.
It's an incredible opportunity to have the chance to be on stage with you, to ask you some questions that I've been wondering about, but also the audience. Mm. We've had the opportunity to have audience submit their questions.
Oh, excellent.
So
I think.
I guess building off of what we've been talking about, the importance of having women in leadership roles, the harassment that women often face online, the audience and myself, we're wondering, what advice would you have for women who are looking to overcome obstacles or barriers in their career?
That's a great question. I would say you need a thick skin, and then you need to double it. And it doesn't matter what industry you're in. You're going to face this as well in law. Certainly journalists, but it does not even matter. You can be working in the banking system, any sector, and sometimes the rules change with no warning for women. And there is definitely a different set of rules culturally, and sometimes we have to just deal with this. So I think my advice is, if you are experiencing any kind of harassment, racism, sexism, ageism, you have to call it out. Nothing is going to change if we keep our mouths shut. But there are consequences.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to pass it over to Yulia.
Yeah, I have our second question here in French. Donc, donc, comment prenez-vous...
So, how do you take care of your mental health? That's interesting in French, because I don't have an answer in French or in English. It's something that I never learned in school.
How do I take care of my mental health? And I've been brutal at it. I've never been a poster child. Je n'ai jamais été un exemple.
I've never been an example of balance between of work-life balance.
I can give you some examples of how I should have, and I remember vividly covering Hurricane Katrina, which was a devastating experience to get there and see. I had just been there on vacation, and now all of a sudden there are bodies all over, everywhere, literally dead bodies for days and days and days. It was a shocking experience. And I was there for about 2 or 3 weeks, and I got back, and a male colleague said to me, yeah, I've really been having some nightmares. I've gone to a therapist. And I thought, well, if he can do it, I'm going to go to a therapist. So I find a therapist, young in St. Clair in Toronto. I call her up. I go to the meeting, or what is it, an appointment. And she asks me one question. I burst out crying, cried for about 45 minutes, and then said, okay, merci, thank you. And she kept calling, saying, I think you need a follow-up. But I was good to go. I mean, and that is the wrong thing to do. To just keep going on to the next story or the next thing without dealing with the ones as they come. And I think younger women are far smarter than their old aunts or their mothers, and I think you have realized that it is not okay to be just keep piling on like that. You have to take care of your mental health. I think maybe because for me it was the 80s, and I just being a woman taken seriously was a lot. And you didn't ever want to take a day off or admit that anything bothered you. Now, thankfully, we've come a long way on mental health, and it's about time, really.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Michelle? All right, so building off of our conversation about the importance of journalism, the importance of trained journalists, and even perhaps I'll throw in, you know, at U Ottawa, I've learned about the importance of having insurance for journalists who are foreign correspondents. Mm. The audience and myself are wondering what recommendations you would have for Canadians who are looking to support high-quality journalism, both in Canada and abroad.
Mm. research is one thing. You're absolutely right. It takes work. But I mean, in this country, we are blessed with incredible journalism. And I don't like the term legacy media, but I get it. It's the ones that have the word legacy equals tradition in this case. So I would say it will cost you. You know, you have to decide. You want the Globe and Mail, or you want whatever your local newspaper is. And you, I get that nobody has cable anymore. I totally understand that. But most, like the CBC, is on YouTube right away, every single night. That's free, isn't it? Yeah. Although if it's free, that means you're the product. I get that too. But anyway, it's there. You have to see, you know, around the world, there are great journalism outlets, houses, podcasts and Substacks, and it's really some of the most innovative stuff I've ever seen, but delivered in a different way. But yes, the journalists, young journalists, they deserve an apartment to live in, food on their table, a living wage, and that means subscribing to good journalism. You just have to support it. So it just, it, you can't just all be free on Facebook or Google.
Here, here.
And our final question from the audience is, where do you see yourself in 5 years?
Oh, wow. Above ground, I hope. I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know, but I'm loving the ride. Let's put it that way. I don't know what, I feel like I'm at this moment in my life where I get to see what is the next chapter. I'm 59 years old. I don't know what it's going to be, but it's an exciting opportunity. And I think that's the key. You know, so many people have faced sudden change in their careers and in their lives, and it's an opportunity as well. And so, I don't know. I'm exploring.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
Thank you. Great Thank questions, you. Ladies. And good luck in your law careers. Wonderful.
Thank you.
We'll always need lawyers as well.
All right. Well, we've got a few minutes left. Are you ready for us? I was going to do one last one because I skipped one.
She saved the big one. Okay. Here
As you were describing all of your experiences, you were talking about a lot of the things that you learned on the job, but then also some of the things you learned from your education. I was wondering if you could just say a few words about how UOttawa set you up and then what you built since then.
Boy, Ottawa U was the foundation for me. I mean, truly, I was living in France. I was a nanny, which is probably why I do not have children to this day. I was a nanny for two little kids. And I thought, okay, I wanted to come to, I wanted to get a university degree. I moved to France when I was 18 for 2 years, came back to this school and thought, all right, it was a bilingual school. I loved the concept of that, loved the location, the politics, loved the critical thinking education that I received here. It changed everything. It became the most important thing for my career, really, is the critical thinking tools I learned in the communications department at University of Ottawa. I'm not even sure. Yeah, critical thinking deserves an applause.
Yes.
And the communications department. You know, it's the one thing I sadly think we're lacking, and it's because we're letting algorithms make those decisions for us, what we should read, who we should believe. Whereas critical thinking was where we got to decide. And why are we ceding that power? And let's reclaim it, because I don't want someone else telling me. I never did. Yeah. I never liked authority. But I don't want them telling me what to think or read or who to believe.
Yeah.
And that I learned that here.
That's incredible. And I think a lot of the things that we're trying to impart through our teaching today is that, you know, the algorithms are kind of here to stay. They're not going anywhere. There's also way too much information for us to individually each consume exactly the right stuff. But applying those critical thinking skills that you're talking about to this media environment and understanding that there's a lot of different things at play that that lead to what's going to be on your screen, and the kinds of things that you've talked about today about the importance of journalism, I think, are another really important layer there. So thank you so much.
I think students are in amaze. Just this time I've spent with you, they are in great hands with you, because I can just hear your critical thinking and how you're teaching them. So
thank
I applaud you.
That's so sweet. I appreciate that. Thank you.